Hello all. Today we are joined by for the very first session of the Career Connect platform. On the second edition of Charger 2021, we're joined by Rahul and Rika, both from Arthan. Arthan, of course, doesn't need a lot of introduction in this audience at the very least. All of us at some point have definitely spoken to or interacted with the platform or spoken to the individuals here in our journey into the development sector itself. This session is largely intended at giving us a quick overview of how the development sector, the landscape of the development sector, and a quick understanding into how does one go about building a fruitful career or a purposeful career within the development sector. With that, I'll hand over the conversation to Rahul and Ritika to take it forward.
Great. Thank you, Akshay. I'll just start sharing my screen. Rahul, is my screen visible?
Yeah, it is.
Great. So before we start, do we want to do like a quick round of introduction of people who are attending the session or maybe in the chat or should we go ahead and start?
Yeah, I think we should have everyone sharing who they are, what do they do, and what are they looking forward to. It would also invoke some degree of conversation in the chat and which will help us talk in a more structured manner. I would recommend everyone doing that. But Ritika, you can start maybe by introducing yourself and I can do my introduction later.
Sure, great. So good morning everyone and welcome to the session on building your purposeful career. My name is Ritika and I've been working with Arthan in the talent acquisition team. If you are familiar with Arthan, you would have come across a lot of our postings via arthancareers.com, which is our personalized jobs platform for opportunities in the impact space, or through various social media platforms like LinkedIn. We have a very robust community on LinkedIn and Facebook as well. So Arthan is essentially a social enterprise committed to strengthening the impact sector ecosystem. We work with social organizations to build their capability and excellence in the areas of human capital, strategy, organizational development, and thought leadership. In the last almost 5 years, we have been working with over 700 social impact organizations and engaged with over 100,000 job seekers across different levels, sectors, and geographies. And Arthan primarily supports mission-driven organizations across three major domains. Firstly, talent management, which is more on the hiring side of things, organizational development, as well as research and thought leadership. So in this session on building your purposeful career, we will be focusing on two main aspects, which is mostly skills in the impact sector as well as networking. I will start and go ahead with the skills in the impact sector. So skills, as we would all know, can be divided into two main categories. One is your hard skills and the other is your soft skills. Your hard skills are transferable skills which you can take from one sector to the other or one job to the other. These are something that are very unique to you and you have trained yourself to develop these skills. Your soft skills are those which can be specific to the sector and can be applied within the role that you're playing across different aspects of your role, across different aspects of your job, as well as in when you switch jobs, the need for your soft skills changes as well. In this session, we will be focusing more on the soft skills aspect of the skills that you need in the impact sector. So just going over the specifics of both these terms, as I mentioned, hard skills are skills that are easy to quantify and can be gained through training or education. So something like a very specific computer programming language or a very specific tool of statistical analysis, SEO, or any other such digital marketing language is a very particular hard skill And this is something that you are more likely to gain from either learning it on the job and then becoming a specialist in that and training yourself more and more in that to become perfect in that skill. Or if it is something that you are trained in the classroom, then you're learning this at a particular school. Soft skills are more nuanced people skills that come with time, experience, and practice. Some very common examples of soft skills are communication, persuasion, adaptability, problem solving, and the list goes on. These are skills that kind of complement your hard skills as well. And over a period of time, as Arthan engages with more and more organizations through our work, we have understood that a balanced combination of hard and soft skills are what is needed in for a career in the impact sector. So this is a very useful example of how hard and soft skills can be placed across the sector. And this is how this is the best way to probably understand how different type of organizations require different kind of hard and soft skills. So typically across the impact sector, you are likely to find four kinds of organizations. The first one being on-ground practitioners, which include nonprofits like maybe Jan Sahas and government bodies, which are working with government stakeholders and implementing certain policies or certain programs at a very grassroots level. A very important hard skill needed here, an example of a very important hard skill needed here are methods of data collection, knowing welfare schemes or public policies that a particular government body is implementing. And a soft skill that might be recommended here is very strong communication skills, because you are interacting with all kinds of stakeholders coming from various backgrounds, various socioeconomic statuses, and the ability to work with ambiguity. Sometimes, for example, if you are working with a civil servant and you are going to a particular government office, you don't know how long you have to wait before you even get a chance to say or talk about the work that you are trying to do. So a lot of ambiguity can also get involved here. Even working on the field involves a lot of ambiguity, because where you're coming from is very different from where you are headed. So being able to work with this kind of ambiguity, being very good at managing different kinds of stakeholders, communicating with different kinds of stakeholders, maybe knowing a local language. These are all examples of soft skills that are very helpful while working with on-ground practitioners. The second type of organization are funding agencies, large foundations, or impact investors. So your Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, Azeem Premji Philanthropic Initiatives, Dell Foundation, etc., which are large grant-making organizations that support smaller or medium-sized organizations to help implement their work. These are what funding agencies, where they will come in. A very important hard skill here is financial compliance, grant-making. Being a CA might complement both of these aspects. And again, a very important soft skill here is stakeholder management, because within this organization, such organizations, you are working with the donor side of people who are responsible for the funds that you're getting, and you're also working with the funding agencies that are receiving the funds. So seeing how their work is impacting, seeing how they are using the funds, you are managing stakeholders from both ends of the spectrum. The third kind of organizations are your intermediaries and ecosystem-focused organizations. These could be very specific consulting organizations that work in a very specific area of work within the sector, or these could be very working across a wide range of problems within the impact sector. So Dalberg, Samagra, Samita, these are some examples of intermediaries. Here, sector-specific or industry-specific knowledge is very important. So for example, if Dalberg is working with a project on education, your knowledge of the education space, your knowledge of working with education organizations or the Department of Education within the government sector is a very specific hard skill that you have developed over a period of time that will be useful here. But other than that, as a soft skill, analytical thinking or problem solving, being able to think laterally and coming up with unique solutions to problems that happen that organizations, such organizations are solving for, is a very important soft skill that can be developed for those who are looking out for opportunities within intermediaries. And lastly, think tanks and research, academic research or research organizations like JPAL. A very particular hard skill is, again, method of data analysis or research methodologies, which are mostly gained from a higher education or even within your basic college degree, which teaches you a lot of these technical aspects of research. And a soft skill mentioned here is critical thinking, visual thinking. How are you able to take in inputs from the research that you've done, take in inputs from the data that you've collected, and come to realizations about what the problem is and how it needs to be solved, is a very important skill within think tanks. So now we'll talk about how we can develop these soft skills. And I think personally, the best part about soft skills, as opposed to hard skills, which have to be developed at your job or at your place of education, is that soft skills can be developed beyond the realm of your professional world, because these are skills that are helpful across your life. Firstly, developing a mindset of learning and openness is a very important way of developing soft skills. The more you are open to trying out different kinds of work that might expose you to new areas of interest, new areas of learning, the better it is for you to learn more soft skills. A very similar example from my life would be when I was interviewing for an opportunity with Arthan. When I entered the organization, I was given the opportunity to take a stab at every different vertical at Arthan. And towards the end of my internship period, I would be at a decision-making space where I can decide what kind of work I want to do and what kind of work I may not want to do right now. This really helped me understand and evaluate what kind of hard and soft skills I would need across each and every vertical. And accordingly, I was able to decide where I want to start building my specialization in within the space of Arthan. So approaching that opportunity with an open mind, being able to try out different kinds of work within the organization, being able to take a stab at things that may be entirely new to me, has helped me understand what I need to develop or what are my interest areas. And that has really helped me grow more soft skills than hard skills that I can apply across different verticals within Arthan. Self-reflection is also a very important aspect of developing soft skills. A lot of times we do certain projects within our work, and once we have completed these projects, we feel very accomplished. And it is at times like these that it's very important that we really reflect on what we did and what are we internalizing from this project. So for example, if I try an absolutely new project, I would, towards the end of this project, I would like to understand for myself what are the soft skills that I could have used or that I was needed to use in this project that I may not have used before, but have contributed to the success of this project. How can I develop or how can I build on this soft skill even more so that I can take up more projects like these? What might be some of the hard skills that I was lacking that I can work on developing and learning to take up more of such work? Self-reflection also comes in from a place of being constantly aware of why you're doing what you're doing and what is it that you are getting out of whatever you're doing. Which leads me to my next point of asking for continuous feedback. A lot of times our self-reflection is also supplemented by the perspectives and opinions of those who are working around us. They might be able to see something that we are not able to see, which is why it is really important to constantly ask for feedback from the people working around you at a peer level, as well as those who are mentoring and supporting you at work. This also helps in seeing things from another perspective. And maybe the next time you do something, you are able to keep the feedback in mind and build on it and develop a certain new aspect of the soft skill you already thought you knew. Expanding your knowledge and understanding. This is also a very critical aspect, not just related to soft skills, but generally about being in the impact sector. It's very important that you are constantly like making yourself aware of what is happening within the sector, whether it is through working with different kinds of organizations or reading and understanding about what is happening in the impact space by reading about the work that others are doing. And also talking to different people, different organizations within the sector, which is something that Rahul will touch more upon. Between the session on networking. But knowing more and more about the sector, how is the sector evolving, what kind of skills are more relevant in the sector, what can you do to make yourself more adaptable to the sector in the future is something that is really helpful. And the best way to do that in a continuous way is by developing your soft skills and constantly evaluating them as per the need of the hour. This leads me to the next part of this session. Leadership skills are something that are very critical in the impact space. And soft skills are what really help in building those leadership skills at any given level. So you do not necessarily have to have 10 or 15 years of experience to be at a leadership position. Within every aspect of the role that you're working on, there is a leadership skill that you are putting across for others to learn from. And how you mend your soft skills or how you kind of mold your soft skills can help in developing those leaderships from a very early beginning. Within the impact sector, your ability to influence your colleagues and peers towards action is a very important aspect. So a lot of times organizations rely on your ability to work with everyone within the organization, regardless of the teams that you're in, and influence and motivate them to work towards a common mission that the organization is working towards. This is really helpful from an organization lens as well as your own lens, because you are able to work, cross-collaborate, and work across different teams. And the more you speak to people or the more you speak to your peers and colleagues, which are not necessarily in your stream of work, the more you're able to influence them and encourage them and understand more about yourself in terms of how you are with working with teams and people. Which leads me to my next point. A lot of times organizations are, there are small teams within a small NGO or a startup, and you are in a position of leading teams, people, as well as organizations. So your ability to work with teams, setting up systems that create trust with you and the people that you're working with, regardless of the experience and the seniority that they come with, is a very important leadership skill that can emerge from soft skills. So being being open to understanding the other person's perspective, being an effective listener, and at the same time being able to influence them with the kind of goals that you are working towards, really helps in managing teams and people. Adaptability and flexibility is something that is really important no matter where you are within the sector. There are a lot of times when your work is very dynamic, regardless of the kind of organizations that you're working with. And you are starting your day with planning something, but halfway into your day, you realize that the priorities of the day have completely changed, and not just for the day, but the entire week. So how quickly are you able to adapt to the changing requirements of what is demanded from you? And how flexible are you to be able to navigate through these changing requirements of your work really helps in building leadership skills that can be catered towards certain kind of crisis management as well. Working with different kinds of stakeholders. Stakeholder management is a very important skill, not just if you're in a role that is external facing, but also internally. A lot of times you would be working with different kinds of vendors or organizations that you are taking a service from. And a lot of times you would be providing that service to different kinds of stakeholders or working cross-collaboratively with such stakeholders. For example, you are working with government stakeholders in a government agency. Your ability to be able to work empathetically, being able to understand the different backgrounds that you and your different stakeholders are coming from, contributes well to such a leadership skill. Operational experience within a company. A lot of times, startups and nonprofit organizations do not have the funds to set up a very specific HR team or a very specific finance team. How well are you able to play your role to even manage these aspects of your team or of your organization? Whether you're able to play a cross-functional role within your particular role is also something that adds to your profile. And it makes you a very useful resource for your organization currently, as well as the future prospects that you would want to explore. And this is also technically related to experience in being in resource-constrained environments. So how are you able to make the best of what you have with the least amount of resources, or being able to work with work in environments that do not necessarily have the best of material resources that you might need for a certain task? If you notice, all of these six points are correlated to each other. One leads to the other, and then the other leads to the next. And it's not a linear process. It's a very continuous process, and while you're working towards yourself, you are also able to include others within your team to build on yourself as well as contribute back to others. And I think that's a very important aspect of being in the impact sector from a perspective of building those skills into yourself. So I will now give the stage to Rahul to talk more about the networking aspect of this.
Great. Thanks, Ritika. It was a very meaningful discussion, and there are a lot of questions that are already coming in. We would definitely take them at the end in the last 20 to 25 minutes that we have planned. But please keep them coming, and please feel free to share your thoughts, what you agree with, and please also share your disagreements with any of the points that you feel that may not be relevant, or you have experienced maybe not exactly what we are saying. But thanks a lot, Ritika. And I think just summarizing, Ritika spoke about a lot of soft skills and hard skills. There was particularly a slide which spoke about the whole ecosystem of impact sector, which divides the impact sector into multiple parts, but what exactly are the soft and hard skills that one needs to develop to leverage those opportunities in those aspects within the ecosystem. So I think thanks a lot. Going into networking, just to do a Wikipedia exercise on it, networking is the action or process of interacting with others to exchange information and develop professional or social contacts. That's what we think when we think about networking. But in a very technical term, and which Deepak Kumar would agree because he's an engineer, he did speak about engineers coming to the sector, the linking of computers to allow them to operate interactively. One of the few words which means the same thing for humans and non-humans, if you think about it. So networking is a very critical aspect. And with the pandemic in 2020, networking has become even more critical, considering there's a lack of FaceTime, there's a lack of engaging more meaningfully, which used to exist previously. So it's very important that you are being very strategic about every aspect or every opportunity that you can leverage to build your career further. Moving forward, here are some thoughts. I think what I've done is, and which I'll be spending some time on, would be what are the 4 to 6 points that one needs to think about when you are thinking about networking. Very critical, and I have tried to make it as contextual as possible with respect to the current times. But feel free to share your thoughts, and maybe even share your thoughts around what has worked personally for you, and would request all the participants to share and share with the larger audience about what worked for you personally. So moving forward, dropping the usual greetings. The first point, Ritika. Under normal circumstances, we would usually use the word like, how are things, hope you are well, but these days hardly anyone is fine. More from the aspect of, I don't think anyone right now is at their absolute best when they are working alone, working in silos, not being able to have any sort of human interaction, maybe beyond family. And I think the first aspect of networking effectively is to acknowledge how things are in the current scheme of things. The chances of you getting a faster response would be high if you show empathy, which is something Ritika also spoke about very actively, about softer skills. That any note, any kind of message, be it WhatsApp, be it emails, be it LinkedIn messaging, or through any social media platform, it's important that you are authentic and you are able to display kindness and sincerity. I think more than that, it's also important that you are also being able to customize your thought process and not using the traditional cut, copy, paste kind of messaging, because I happen to receive so many emails, so many messages on social media platforms, which does not seem to be authentic. It seems to just be very transactional. And this point is to kind of hit home the point that one needs to be very empathetic in the current times. but feel free to share what do you think about this point. Moving forward, Ritika, networking has always been about giving and not receiving, but it has gained more importance in the current times. Many a time in our desperation, we are not able to think strategically. We are always thinking transactionally. When I say the difference between strategically and transactional is, I am desperate to find a job, or I want a meeting with a possible funder, or I want to kind of connect to a potential partner in terms of programs. I am desperate because I have a goal in mind, and usually such messages go unheard. We need to start looking at possibilities or ways or thinking innovatively to see how we can connect to people with an aspect of giving in mind and not just receiving in mind. Couple of examples that I can think of is if you are a social media person, if you're a social media person or an SEO expert, I have seen so many people writing to me talking about our website's UI UX, or talking about, you know what, I tried logging in on your website. I feel there can be a couple of clicks here which can enable better user experience. That has pushed me to engage with that person more versus people who come to me and say, I am looking for a social media marketing role at Arthur. It's about just being slightly smarter, but also trying to show that you are definitely someone who is valuable enough to spend time with. But at the same time, I'm not transactional. I'm also adding value to what I can bring. Just one more example that comes to my mind. There was a person from who was looking for opportunities in EdTech. He happened to write to a founder and talk about how how the product of this EdTech firm has been helping his own child at home, and how the experience of the child has been seamless. And it was more like a feedback to the person. But once that conversation started engaging, he then spoke about the requirement of being in EdTech and adding more value in the ecosystem. So I think one needs to be very strategic. You need to really identify what you want to bring through the conversation, but at the same time, what you want to receive. It has to be a two-way street and not a one-way street. And that will go a long way in building a more meaningful relationship, which can lead to a network that you can leverage. And like I said, being authentic from the first point is also critical. You can't just write to people hoping for a hit by just being at the periphery of what you want to discuss. Be very authentic, be very tactful, but at the same time, be very direct. It's moving forward, Ritika, being more patient. I think there's a saying that if you write, it's a funnel, right? If you write to 100 people, you might get 2 responses. And coming from the banking industry, especially in sales, in the first half of my career, there was a saying, if you make 10 calls, only 2 people will respond and 1 person will give you a meeting. So that's 10% conversion, right? So, and it holds the same logic even for networking. So the first point that I mentioned on the slide is, be glad anyone gets back at all. So be very patient. Everyone's jobs and lives are upended. People are more busier. There have been research reports, especially about how work-life balance has taken a hit in the pandemic. People are more busier. People are doing 15, 16-hour shifts, literally going from household work to work. In some cases, even doing it parallelly. People are having challenges managing kids at home. Kids are also not going to school because of schools being shut. You need to remember that whilst you are writing to people, there are tons and tons of people also writing to people. And people are prioritizing who to reply first. So it's very important that you need to be patient. Don't get into too many repeated reminders, but have a strategy around it. Like, how frequent can your reminders be? When can you remind? And keep a tracker. as to how frequent can you send reminders. And the approach of reminders should be also different. And also, while you are planning for reminders, also think about first degree, second degree of connection. The chances of you getting a hit will be higher if someone from your first degree of connection who knows the person you want to connect with can connect you. So I think also being very strategic about it and understanding the network within networking is even more critical, right? So I think these are some of the aspects that will go a long way in helping you network more effectively. Like I said, me and Ritika will be spending the last 20 minutes taking your questions. Feel free to ask questions and ask what specific challenges you are facing when it comes to networking. Moving forward, relationship-focused networking is... I think I have covered these points invariably in all the points that I have discussed before. This is going to be a very critical point. Like, it's very important that you understand your network first. Understand who you know really well, who are also very well connected to the person you want to connect with. So make it more relationship driven. But like I said, even to ask for recommendations, you need to move beyond transactions. You need to give as you receive. So if I reach out to Ritika to connect, asking her to connect to someone in her network, I need to also offer something to Ritika which she would find valuable to make it more relationship driven and not transactional driven. It is important to create win-wins, have chats, and networking is relevant not just for jobs. Here, I'm sure there are people on this discussion forum who are hiring managers for their organizations. There are people who are founders in these organizations. Always block time in your calendar to meet people without any transaction in mind. Just to give you an example, I spend 8 hours of my week every week, and I've been diligently following that for the past 12 months to speak to people with no agenda in mind, which is I'm not looking to hire someone or I'm not looking to work with a client specifically, but these conversations have helped me gain deeper relationships, which I don't know when will I leverage, but I believe that it will go a long way in helping me build my own brand in the ecosystem, but also at the same time help people understand how I approach networking. So it's important that you are able to track your conversations on a weekly basis and then learning from it on a frequent basis. Moving forward, using networking websites effectively, using networking platforms effectively. The Career Connect today is a great platform. There are so many people who are thinking alike or who think alike who will be a part of this forum. Most of the conversations and chats are very public in nature, which makes you think that you can even connect to people outside of Career Connect as well. We are also, just to reiterate, and I know Akshay has been talking about this, we from 12 o'clock till afternoon, we have so many organizations coming and talking about open jobs in their respective organizations. Even though some of the organizations may not resonate with you in terms of the cause that they are trying to solve for, I would still say that you should attend those sessions to understand what kind of hard skills or soft skills they are hiring for, what kind of people exist in the social sector. So I think it's very important that you leverage every kind of forum website effectively. And there's a saying, it's not just about a like or a heart to network. It's also about commenting, sharing. I would say take this chance in the next 20 minutes. If you had a light bulb moment in this session by anything that Ritika or I shared, use the hashtag Charcha2021 and share your thought with your network on LinkedIn, Facebook, Instagram, wherever. That will mean that you are effectively using your thought process to network with your audience. In addition to sharing your content, thoughtfully comment on other people's content as well, and ask questions, spark discussions, agree to disagree. Use networking platforms to make the world known that you exist. And this is the way you think. These are the problems that you definitely are looking forward to solving for, and how you can meaningfully connect to people who think like you. I think that's going to be very critical in the I don't know when the pandemic will end, but I think in the future people are more active on social media than ever before. So it's important that you stay relevant with the moving world. Moving forward, a very critical data which I happened to read on LinkedIn. I don't know how many of you, I know many of you read LinkedIn articles, but think about this. 45% of all LinkedIn article readers are in upper level positions. So my first question to the audience here today is, how many of you have written LinkedIn articles? So when you go on LinkedIn, when you start a post, there is a question: start a post, start a article, start a poll. How many of you have started an article? How many of you have gone beyond your comfort zone to start or write your own content? Remember, writing your own content will attract a whole new network to your LinkedIn page. And I'm just using LinkedIn as an example. There are so many different platforms already that exist. So how do you use that is going to be very critical. And as you share more content, the chances of people hearing you, people understanding your views will go that much higher in numbers. So I think these are some of the tips that I had regarding networking, and would love to take some questions. Thank you, Madhurima, for vouching for my thoughts, but we'll definitely take into questions. The first question that was asked today was by Joju Vargas. Hi, everyone. I am working with Cry. What are the trends in recruiters, organizations looking for post-COVID scenario? So maybe I can take part of the question, but I also believe Ritika spoke about 6 skills that organizations are looking for. And these are changing times. Organizations are very particular about the kind of people they will hire. Experimentation is lower now. People require, if there are 10 skill sets that one needs to tick mark on, organizations are not compromising because funds are less. Pandemic has overall given a hit to the sector, right? Organizations are very particular about stakeholder management, ability to work remotely, ability to engage purposefully when there's less support. I think those are some of the things that organizations are definitely looking forward to when they are interviewing people. Secondly, I think hard skills like writing, ability to being very sales driven. When I say sales driven, you are very outcome oriented. Pushing yourself, striving yourself to achieve results. I think those are very relevant skills that were always present. But I think ability to work remotely, ability to engage with stakeholders, being very innovative in your approach, especially to interact with funders, donors, is something that organizations are constantly looking for, especially in the post-COVID or in the present scenario. I hope that answers your question. Ritika, you have anything to add?
No, I think, Rahul, you captured it very well. That, and I think a few points that I mentioned that I was just going through the discussion. I was not able to see the chat while I was presenting, but I believe the part of the presentation also answered some of Joju's questions.
Sure. So Deepak has answered, how would an engineering graduate enter the social sector without these hard skills? Because the degree restricts acquiring hard skills, there is very rare case of bypassing them and getting a chance to showing the soft skills. I think it all depends, Deepak, on what is the kind of role you are applying to. I feel being an engineer, you already have an hard skill, which is very rare to be found. more and more organizations in the social sector are building a technology muscle. As every corporate sector organization constantly think, social sector organizations are also thinking about scale. How can we serve more and more people better and in an efficient manner? Technology will obviously play a large role in helping achieve those goals. I believe for an engineer like you, it is very critical that you are working on what are the specific hard skills with respect to technology, if technology kind of roles are something that you are applying for or you are thinking about. I would say, what are the technological languages that are relevant for the social sector? What are kind of stacks, technical stacks that one needs to be proficient in? But like I said, soft skills around collaboration, working in smaller teams, unlike corporate sector organizations or large organizations like Amazon, which will have 10 front-end developers, 10 back-end developers, 3 data scientists, and 5 product managers. That is the kind of affordability you can't see in the social sector. They might hire a full-stack developer who knows all the things. So I would say, to excel in the social sector, you need to be very collaborative, be very frugal in terms of thinking, because the kind of money available or resources available will be less. So I think the biggest hard skill is, how can you build the best product by using the least resources is the best hard skill that you can have as an engineer. And if you are a fresher, I think most organizations are pretty open because you will be much more flexible. Ritika, you want to answer the question? You were a fresher when you joined us.
Yeah, I think, and this is something that I also mentioned about being very open-minded. If you are a fresher looking to get into the sector, I would say enter the sector as open-mindedly as possible and take a stab at any and every kind of work that you're getting to do. Not only will that open more doors for you, but it'll also give you a chance to understand what your interest areas are. How can you develop those interest areas further and develop skills relevant to those interest areas as well. And the best part about a fresher entering the sector is that skills are still in the process of being built and they can very well be taught. So even your hard skills, people are willing to invest in you and teach you those hard skills so that you become become better at what you're doing and then contribute meaningfully to the organization as well.
Yeah. But like I said, I think it's also important that you read a lot more about the sector. Read a lot. I would say break down what is the cause that will keep you awake at night. Is it child education? Is it women empowerment? Is it gender inclusion? Is it water and sanitation? So first of all, Deepak, I would say think about what is the problem that you would want to solve. Once you have defined that, think about all the organizations within that problem. So water and sanitation is, if that is the cause that you want to solve for, what are the 20, 30, 50, 100 organizations that encompass in that space? Then do a lot of reading. What is the kind of problems that this side of the social impact sector is struggling with? And when you are trying to network and when you are trying to build your skill set, try to marry it with the challenges that the sector is facing. So for example, I would say if you are passionate about education sector, you already know, right? Schools are shut. Teachers are constantly sitting on Zoom and trying to teach children. If you as an engineer can build a very strong teacher onboarding course and think about how can teachers be experts at using Zoom, and if I can take that course, if I know that training teachers online is the biggest challenge an edtech firm is facing, I can take that product or the solution to edtech founders and say, I am Deepak, I am an engineer, I built this, I can help you train teachers better. I thought of a module that will help teachers kickstart their teaching careers on Zoom effectively within 1 week. I am sure any founder today will read that message and immediately write to you back. But like I said, read a lot about the sector that you are passionate about. Remember interview 101. I remember when I was young, I used to go for interviews. If you tell an interviewer my favorite subject is economics, you have to be prepared for every question that can be asked in that interview within economics. So if you are passionate about edtech, read about edtech, read about the challenges that education sector is facing today, which can be both on the funding side as well as on the program implementation side, both. I think knowledge is something which will go a long way in helping you position yourself better. Thanks a lot for that question. What's next? Laurie Colaco, with a decade plus of career in vocational and skill development, my core skills are employability, international hiring. I teach in college. However, I'm looking to make a change in the social sector to create bigger impact. Thanks a lot, Laurie. There are multiple roles where people like you would be effective in. I think there are so many skill development consultancies, think tanks and consulting firms which are working on employability and skill development today who would love to have a person like you. I believe a couple of organizations today in the Career Connect are also coming from that background. So would urge you to log in again post 12 p.m. to attend those sessions. Otherwise, feel free to reach out to us if you need any support beyond. Aparna has written, hi everyone, this is Aparna, pursuing MSW, looking forward to building my career, looking forward to connecting with you as well. Vaibhav has asked a relevant question. Hi Rahul and Ritika, I understand that social sector is resource restrained. What are the opportunities to work in a part-time manner? Vaibhav, the same response that I would give, that I gave to Deepak as well. Opportunities are available. There are many part-time consulting opportunity-specific websites as well, where you can apply for consulting work. But at the same time, I think more and more organizations are open to hire gig employees, wherein, as you know, resource constraint means I can't hire a person full-time, because I can't presume that there is work for that particular employee for the next 12 months or 15 months or 2 years. So what if I can hire strong talent for project basis, and that'll help me leverage the talent well, but at the same time, it's a win-win situation. Like I said, Vaibhav, the opportunity is there, but you need to really understand the sector or the domain within which you want to apply for. Like I said, in the current situation, fundraising is a very critical skill that organizations are looking for. Just to, like Ritika can vouch for it, every other role that Arthan manages is a fundraising role. Or even within other roles, there is a fundraising aspect within the role. So I think if proposal writing, your ability to write, your ability to network, your ability to understand the ecosystem, if it's there, fundraising as a role can be a very attractive proposition for you. So if that is a role that you want to take head on in a part-time manner, there are opportunities. But I, like I said, to help you better, I need more specific questions from you. I hope that was helpful.
I think Vaibhav asks a specific question later. He mentioned that LinkedIn has a 300 character limit, and traditional knowledge suggests that being on the point and directly going to the task leaves us with very little space for personalization. And I agree with that, Vaibhav. The reason why they have kept that limited space is so that people don't go on and on about themselves or what they're looking for. But I think in my experience, a quick 1 or 2 line introduction to yourself without necessarily even mentioning the ask is a good starting point. Just introducing yourself and why you're looking forward to connect with someone and not jumping the gun is a good way to at least start off the connection. And once the connection happens, then you can go into detail about what you're looking for or what you would like to contribute to. What about you, Rahul? In your experience, does that work with you?
Yeah, I think there is a reason why LinkedIn has kept it. Secondly, if you be very transactional and if you write to tons and tons of people using those 200 words to be more direct, there's a chance out of those 100, 90 will not even accept your request. If 90 don't accept your request, LinkedIn will treat you as spam and not allow you to connect further. And that happens a lot. The reason being, LinkedIn has an algorithm to figure that out. So it's also important that when you are writing to people using the 300 word limit, majority of them connect with you back. And for that to happen, you need to go beyond transactional conversation. So I think LinkedIn will help you achieve that. But like I said, be more cognizant about how you are connecting to people. Parul has asked in Q&A, how should you network for the role of organization change in mid-career? I think, Parul, the first thing is, what do you want to do? I think that's the first thing. So the first step is the cause or the problem that you want to solve. What will keep you awake at night? Because that needs to be absolutely necessary. Otherwise, 2 years later, you will want to make one more change. The first thing is, what is the cause I want to work on? Second is, how do I figure out the organizations within that cause? And then I have to figure out the people within those organizations who have made a shift in mid-career or who have moved from a different career to that career. And how can I meaningfully connect with them first to identify, how did you make this shift? What helped you? Can you give me some tips? Can we set up a 20-minute call to discuss? That will enable you to build meaningful connections and eventually understand the sector better. So I feel a lot of secondary research, which is going on Google, going on LinkedIn to figure out information, but also doing primary research of interviewing people in a survey kind of a format or conversations. I think that is the first step to do it. I would say, applying to jobs without understanding the role or the cause will not help you get strong results. Also, reach out to organizations like who are recruitment organizations in the ecosystem who can help you understand the role better even before you apply. I think that will also go a long way. What are the don'ts that one should keep in mind while networking? I think I mentioned that throughout the presentation of networking, Chatura. This is a question by Chatura. The don'ts are, don't keep it transactional, make it more relationship based. Don't go overboard in reminders and constantly pinging people, expecting them to be responsible in terms of responses within 24 hours. It does not happen. Also remember, people are generally more busy. It will take time. And thirdly, I think these are the two big tips, right? Being more patient and being less transactional. I think these are the two things that I will keep in mind, definitely. Vaibhav has already, you touched upon the affordability of talent. If you can shed some light on what is the difference in those aspects. Affordability of talent in the social impact sector. I did not understand this question, Vaibhav. If you can rephrase it again, that would be helpful. Ayushi, what are the few things that a candidate needs to ensure while interviewing at a social impact org? What kind of questions can we have? Ritika, you want to take this?
Yes. As a fresher, I think a lot of your conversations with your employer would be about more about your personality, what are your interest areas, what do you think are the hard and soft skills you already come with. To give you an example of how this can be gauged, a recruiter or an interviewer will look at your CV or will talk to you about your extracurricular experience for that matter. So how well are you able to manage your academics or be present in a classroom while still managing being a part of multiple societies in college? This goes on to show that you are able to manage the two very important aspects in your college, as well as develop hard and soft skills with the classroom and outside the classroom. Your ability to problem solve or to think laterally across different kinds of problems is also that might be tested. So think about what kind of experiences in your life have led you to be in problem solving situations, and how did you go about it? I remember one of my peers being asked, what are some of the risks that you have taken in your wherever you are, whether it is at work or in college or in society, and what was your learning from there? So most of your questions will be around understanding where you are coming from and your ability to problem solve, reflect, take these kind of risks. I think that's a good starting point. And I think every organization has their own ways of going about these interviews. Every organization has different priorities when it comes to looking out for certain aspects of your profile. So doing some research within the organization to see what kind of people are working there will also be helpful. I think I can also take the next question, which is about the same space. Glory mentioned about how during internships, you realize what your interests are, and top tier colleges have good connections with good organizations, and it gets easier for those students to grab internships. Glory, I don't think that's necessarily the case. I think most organizations in the social sector, especially at a fresher level, don't necessarily look at your academic credentials, or at least to the extent of seeing which college you come from. What they do prioritize is maybe how academically inclined you are when it comes to what marks you score. If it is not internships, I think even through volunteering opportunities, networking with people within the organization that you see yourself working with, those kind of help in opening and creating opportunities and opening doors to the kind of organizations that you want to work with. But I think it is easy to get internships. I think most of these platforms on LinkedIn as well as InternShala has a lot of internship opportunities. And honestly, organizations are just looking for people who are interested in the impact sector and come with a very basic level of skills. The rest can be taught and developed on the job. So I think you should be open-minded about this and don't think that just because you're not coming from a tier one college, you don't have access to the impact sector.
Aparna has asked a question and we have very little time, so this can be the last question, but feel free to write to me or Ritika. Ritika, you can mention our email addresses on the chat. How can a fresher like me be a part of the development sector, as most of the organizations these days are asking for experience even for entry-level jobs? I feel, Aparna, it's not just about job. There are so many opportunities like fellowships in the social sector which you can access. If you go to Arthan's blog, there's a list of almost 50 fellowships across different causes. You have a climate change fellowship, which is called the Anand Fellowship. You have a fellowship for education, which is called Teach for India. You have a community development focused fellowship, which is Kaivalya Fellowship. You have a fellowship for working with MPs and bureaucrats called the LAM Fellowship. There's so much to do. There is Young India Fellowship with Ashoka University, and I feel as a fresher, you can access so many different fellowships to understand the larger ecosystem of the development sector. But at the same time, be very cause-driven. So you can also go into a hyper-focused fellowship as well, which is more in tune to what you want to do eventually in your career. So I feel start looking at those opportunities as well. But like I said, I think even for entry-level jobs, I agree, maybe they would want some level of experience, but that's mostly to judge the ability of passion and drive that this person has towards the work that we do, not necessarily looking at expertise. So I think even your kind of volunteering experiences in college, there has to be some level of journey that you would have had to get here. And that's what organizations are looking to judge. But like I said, there are organizations out there who would hire right after college as well. So I would say before you start thinking about which job, I would say don't look at it from a job perspective. Look at it from a organization and the cause perspective first. That's what I would suggest. But thanks a lot. I think we have very little time. We need to move into the next session. It's already 11. I would log off. Feel free to join me, Akansha, Vasudha, and Kruti in the next session, which starts, it has already started. And feel free to join us on the Career Connect later in the day. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, everyone.